Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Japan Runs Wild, 1942 to 1943, by Peter Harmsen, narrated by Walter Dixon. Preface. This book is about the crucial first 2 years of the war between Japan and the Western powers, led by the United States. By referring to 1942 and 1943 as the early years of the conflict in the Asia-Pacific, we immediately betray a Eurocentric view of the war. By the time of the attack on Pearl Harbor, the peoples of Asia, including first and foremost the Japanese and the Chinese, were already tragically well acquainted with war. A low-intensity conflict had erupted a decade earlier, exploding into full-scale war in 1937. As with the first volume of this trilogy, this second volume seeks to encompass the totality of the war by introducing the perspective of the people whose nations became the battlegrounds and staging areas for the cataclysmic conflict towards the middle of the past century. For Chinese names, I have used pinyin transliteration, now used almost universally, and I follow Chinese practice of placing family names first. Japanese family names are also placed first in this text. The 1940s were a different time, and language has evolved. This leaves contemporary authors with the issue of tackling denigrating language. In Western media, and sometimes even in official communication, the Japanese enemy was routinely described as the Japs or the Nips. I have decided to leave this vocabulary wherever it occurs. It is the job of the historian to describe the past, not to gloss it over. Chapter 1. Victory in the Pacific. Early December 1941. What the Royal Navy's Admiral Tom Phillips lacked in physical stature, he made up for in fiery temper. Nicknamed Tom Thumb and described as all brains and no body because of his diminutive 5'4", his explosive outbursts were legendary. Even in the rough-and-ready world inhabited by British sailors, it was not common to throw heavy ashtrays at subordinates, as he had once done in a fit of anger. Now, at the age of 53, all his combative energies were needed more than ever. In the dark waning days of 1941, he was about to meet the foe of a lifetime, the Japanese Empire. At his disposal, he had a fleet designated Force Z, consisting of his own flagship, Prince of Wales, launched just 2 years earlier, and the older battlecruiser Repulse, as well as 4 destroyers. As he sailed out of Singapore at 5:35 p.m. on December 8th, heading north to engage vessels of the Japanese Navy that were landing men and materiel at the city of Singora, near the Thai-Malay border, he could hardly conceal his excitement. "We are out looking for trouble," he signaled to his men, "and no doubt we shall find it." Force Z had acted fast. When its gray hull sailed down the Singapore Straits into the South China Sea, the Pacific had been ablaze for less than a day. It was not even 24 hours since the first Japanese troops had set foot on the beaches of Malaya, followed shortly afterwards, but several time zones away, by a surprise assault on the U.S. Navy's Hawaiian base at Pearl Harbor. From then on, Japanese forces had landed blow after blow with breathtaking speed. They had targeted the Americans in the Philippines in fierce air raids. They had crossed the border with Hong Kong. They had shut down the foreign enclaves in China, some of them a century old. For the Western powers, the bad news kept coming in. Still, little was known about Japan's plans and capabilities. In effect, Admiral Phillips was setting Force Z on a course for the unknown. He was accepting a considerable risk, but it could hardly be any different. It was not in the Royal Navy's nature and tradition to hide timidly at port while the other branches were fighting for their lives. The heirs of Trafalgar had to step into the fray. The men of Force Z were in high spirits. The Prince of Wales had arrived in the Far East, basking in the glory of one of the few British successes at this stage of the war. Earlier that year, they had participated in the sinking of the German battleship Bismarck. Having beaten the elite of the Kriegsmarine, many of them believed the Japanese would be no serious match. An American war correspondent who had been allowed to travel with Force Z listened in on the chatter among the officers on board. "Those Japs can't fly," one of them said. "They can't see at night, and they are not well trained. another added. They have rather good ships, but they can't shoot. They were supported in these views by a consensus in the West about the military capabilities of Hirohito's warriors, or their lack thereof. Fletcher Pratt, an influential writer, had played down the threat posed by Japanese pilots, arguing that their national character condemned them to mediocrity in the air. The aviator is peculiarly alone, he had written in a widely read text 2 years earlier, and the Japanese, poor individualists, are thus poor aviators. In fact, the Japanese were ahead in the game of air power. Admiral Phillips was no stranger to the Far East, having served in its waters during the previous World War, but he was also a traditional Navy man who had long expressed doubts about the importance of naval aviation. On the face of it, his confidence was justified, as the close-range anti-aircraft weapons of his flagship included 16 5.25-inch guns, 48 2-pounders, two 40-millimeter Bofors guns, and a dozen 20-millimeter Oerlikon cannon and Lewis machine guns. Still, his thinking on the subject was formed by the conflicts of the past, not the future. At a meeting of senior British officers a few years earlier, veteran aviator Arthur Harris, later known as Bomber Harris, had told him, in weirdly prophetic fashion, "I had the strangest dream last night, Tom. I saw your future so clearly. War was declared in the East, and the Japanese had taken Siam. You'd been promoted admiral, and you set off in your flagship up the east coast of Malaya to deal with the situation. Suddenly, down comes a rain of bombs and torpedoes. You look down from your bridge and say, 'What a lot of mines we've hit.'" Phillips may not have remembered Harris's prescient words, as he now found himself in the precise situation that he had forecast. But more recently, the admiral had come around to the revolutionary potential of modern aeronautics, and he now understood that aircraft did indeed pose very real dangers to surface vessels. Therefore, he was doubly concerned by messages he received from Singapore during December 9th, his second day at sea. On the one hand, he was informed that he would not be getting the fighter protection he had requested at Singora. On the other, he received a warning that land-based Japanese bomber planes were believed to be deployed in southern Indochina within easy striking range. Late in the day, a Japanese aircraft was sighted over the horizon, making it all but certain that Force Z had been discovered by the enemy. Weighing the odds, Phillips decided to turn around and steer back towards Singapore. It would, the U.S. Navy's official historian later remarked, have been a happy ending had he persisted in this resolve. What made Phillips change his mind was a telegram arriving from Singapore shortly before midnight. Enemy reported landing Kuantan. The city of Kuantan, on the east coast of the Malay Peninsula, was located much further south than any previously reported landings, and if the Japanese succeeded in establishing a foothold there, it would drastically change the strategic situation, putting Singapore within much easier reach of rapidly moving infantry. Kuantan was not too far from the route that Force Z had planned for its return journey anyway, and Phillips decided to make a detour for the reported Japanese landing zone. Given everything that Phillips knew at the time, which was not much, it was not an unsound decision. Less sound was his decision not to call for air support from Singapore. He did not want to break radio silence, and might have believed that aircraft would be sent as a matter of course, due to the obvious urgent need to contain the Japanese landing force. As it turned out, there was no Japanese landing force at Kuantan. The intelligence had been flawed, and therefore, there was also no intention whatsoever in Singapore of sending fighters to the area. When Force Z approached Kuantan at dawn on December 10th and found no large assembly of Japanese vessels in the process of disembarking troops, it was clear to Admiral Phillips that he had made a mistake. But by now, it was already too late. Force Z had ended up in a trap, partly of its own making. Unbeknownst to the British officers on board, the Prince of Wales and Repulse had been spotted, along with their support vessels, once again the day before, this time by a Japanese submarine. And since then, Genzan Air Group, stationed in Saigon in southern Indochina, had been on the lookout for the ships. A few hours after daybreak, the Japanese aviators located the British fleet, and at about 11 a.m., the attacks began. with a mixture of bombers and torpedo planes. Lieutenant Takai Sadao, leader of a torpedo squadron, later remembered being taken aback by the complete lack of enemy air cover. Much to our surprise, not a single enemy plane was in sight. This was all the more amazing since the scene of the battle was well within the fighting range of the British fighters. Even though they were left to their own devices, the British ships were able to put up a tremendous fight. And as the Japanese planes closed in on their targets, the anti-aircraft guns opened up. The sky was filled with bursting shells, which made my plane reel and shake, Takai later recalled. The smell and smoke of the enemy barrages entered the Japanese aircraft, adding to the intensity of the situation. Flight Seaman First Class Uno Susumo was in the first wave of attacks on the Repulse, and saw his and his fellow aviators' torpedoes all miss the target. We and our airplanes attacked the enemy as if we were a fireball, and still we failed, he said to himself, in a daze and with tears of rage rolling down his cheeks. Undeterred by the initial failure, the Japanese planes kept coming, and in the course of two subsequent waves, the Prince of Wales was hit repeatedly and reduced to a sitting duck, unable to dodge further attacks. The Japanese pilots proceeded with devastating efficiency, flying into the wall of bullets and shrapnel hurled against them from below. Such cool-headed and imperturbable firings, the same as those in peacetime training, were seen everywhere, so that it was not by accident that many torpedo hits were scored, the commanding officer of the Genzan Air Group reported later. Similar cold-blooded behavior was displayed on the British side. On board the Repulse, American CBS correspondent Cecil Brown was struck by the crew's almost otherworldly sang-froid. Each shell delivered to the service gun was handed over with a joke. The men were having the time of their lives, Brown thought to himself, and later wrote in his diary, I never saw such happiness on men's faces. The valor displayed by the British sailors could not change the sad fate of both ships, and even the skillful maneuvering of William Tennant, captain on board the Repulse, was insufficient. I found dodging the torpedoes quite interesting and entertaining, until in the end they started to come in from all directions, and they were too much for me, he wrote later. About 90 minutes into the battle, his ship was at journey's end. Stand by for barrage, a metallic voice warned over the ship's communication system. The crew could see a plane at 300 or 400 yards approaching from the port side. As it came closer, it dropped its torpedo, which headed straight for the Repulse. This one's got us, one of the sailors said, watching helplessly as the white stripe darted towards them just below the surface of the water. The torpedo struck about 20 yards astern from where Cecil Brown was standing. It felt like the ship had crashed into a well-rooted dock, he wrote. It threw me 4 feet across the deck. It was the death blow for the Repulse. Captain Tennant ordered all hands to abandon ship, and just minutes later, it rolled over. As the men flocked on the upturned starboard side, Tennant left the bridge and joined them. It was strange walking along what was normally a vertical surface, he wrote later. Without any feeling of the ship going down, the sea came up and took me. Almost at once, I was sucked down into the water that was very black and no light at all. Seconds later, he bobbed up to the surface and heard a shout from a life raft just feet away. Here you are, sir. Come on. He was among 796 officers and men rescued from the Repulse, out of an original complement of 1,309. Phillips, on board the Prince of Wales, was not that lucky. Assaulted repeatedly by both torpedo planes and bombers, his ship managed to stay afloat for nearly an hour longer than the Repulse, but listed dangerously. Some of the wounded were evacuated by gangplank to the destroyer HMS Express, where able seaman Shiner Wright helped them over the side. He was horrified by the sight of sailors whose skin had been burned off by bursting steam pipes. They were so badly burnt they wouldn't allow us to touch them, he said later of the gruesome experience. Even the Japanese pilots, circling around the doomed ship like merciless birds of prey, were able to appreciate the tragedy unfolding. As we dived in for the attack, I didn't want to launch my torpedo. It was such a beautiful ship. Such a beautiful ship, one of them said later. With only minutes to go before the mighty hull would be devoured by the waves, the crew were scrambling to save themselves. But Phillips was seen on the bridge, slumped on a stool in complete despair. "I cannot survive this," he said, apparently resigned to stay with the ship. At 1:20 p.m., it turned upside down and sank. Altogether, 327 of the crew of 1,612 went to the bottom. Phillips was one of them. Only now, when all was lost, did friendly aircraft arrive. Flight Lieutenant T.A. Vickers, from the Royal Australian Air Force Base at Sembawang near Singapore, piloted the first airplane to reach the area after the two vessels had been sunk. He saw hundreds of men clinging to bits of wreckage and swimming in filthy, oily water. It would be hours before they could all be picked up, and in the meantime, they might be subjected to further air attack. "Yet, as I flew round, every man waved and put his thumb up as I flew over him," Vickers wrote in a report immediately afterwards. "After an hour, lack of petrol forced me to leave, but during that hour, I had seen many men in dire danger waving, cheering and joking, as if they were holidaymakers at Brighton waving at a low-flying aircraft." Half a world away in Britain, it was still morning, and Prime Minister Winston Churchill received the news of the disaster by telephone while he was lying in bed. He had been warned about the risk of sending the Prince of Wales to the Far East, where the Japanese Navy enjoyed clear superiority. The British leader had not listened, and now he was forced to face the consequences. It was the most direct shock of the entire war, he later recalled. "As I turned over and twisted in bed, the full horror of the news sank in upon me. There were no British or American capital ships in the Indian Ocean or the Pacific, except the American survivors of Pearl Harbor, who were hastening back to California. Over all this vast expanse of waters, Japan was supreme, and we everywhere were weak and naked." It was yet another blow to British pride, of which there had been many over the preceding 2 years, but in some ways it was worse than the others. Harold Macmillan, the future Prime Minister, described the humiliation, almost incredulity, with which the news was received by the British, a maritime nation at heart. "Our people are accustomed to setbacks, even disasters on land," he wrote in his memoirs, "but defeat at sea is another thing." 1 week later, in a bitter reminder of how fast fortunes could change in a time of war, John Kennedy, one of Churchill's chief military aides, received a much-delayed letter that Admiral Phillips had penned during his voyage from the Atlantic to the Far East. Displaying happy ignorance of the misfortunes lying ahead, it said, "It is grand to be at sea again." The Japanese Empire seemed unbeatable in December 1941. Yet the Japanese people initially displayed an almost apathetic attitude towards the war, and only gradually worked up a level of enthusiasm to match the astonishing victories abroad. In the morning of December 8th, just hours after the attack on Pearl Harbor, the young German diplomat Erman Wickert took the tram through Tokyo, watching his co-passengers read newspapers that had been printed during the night while there was still peace. None of them talked, and everyone seemed unaffected, although there was little doubt most knew their country was now at war with the strongest power on earth. They probably had not yet completely fathomed the news and were looking for an explanation in yesterday's reports, Wickert wrote. Robert Guillon, a French journalist, noticed the same subdued mood in Japan's capital and guessed that some might even harbor quiet anger at the predicament their leaders had placed the nation in. "In the streets," he wrote, "people showed surprise as they were reading the first special editions of the newspapers and muted dismay. Fear was taking hold of them as they understood the folly that Japan had committed." Later the same day, shop owners set up loudspeakers outside their stores, and each time news was broadcast, people would gather around to listen, quiet and without moving. Youth groups and paramilitary bands walked to the Emperor's Palace and the Yasukuni Shrine, where Japan's war dead were commemorated. Some also strode by the German embassy, shouting, "Banzai!" in shrill voices. "You couldn't hear much excitement," Wickert commented dryly, as many seemed to be showing support for the war out of a sense of duty rather than any inner conviction. The Tokyo Stock Exchange, which perhaps expressed the public mood in the most honest fashion because money was at stake, triggered particular concern, and even before the markets opened, the finance ministry arranged for supportive buying of shares to take place. It did not help much, and stock prices experienced an initial downward trend in reaction to the war news, only to gain ground again after news started trickling in about sweeping early successes in the Pacific. Little by little, as reports of the rapid advances became better known at home, the Japanese public began displaying a greater degree of fervor. Crowds were now cheering when newsreels boasted about fresh triumphs, and on the airwaves, radio announcements of new advances mixed with an endless stream of patriotic marches. The town was full of waves of rising sun flags, Sakamoto Tane, the wife of a judge in the city of Kochi, wrote in her diary, and we celebrated together the string of Imperial Army victories. The young and impressionable were especially affected. I felt as if my blood boiled and my flesh quivered, said Koshu Itabashi, a middle school student, recalling his emotions when hearing reports about new Japanese victories abroad. The whole nation bubbled over, excited and inspired. We really did it! Incredible! Wonderful! That's the way it felt then. Emperor Hirohito himself also displayed growing enthusiasm. The divine ruler, who followed the progress of war with great attention to detail in a special map room established in his palace, had reacted with calm to the reports about the success at Pearl Harbor. But, as the victories started accumulating, his mood improved, almost as if he could not believe his own luck. The results of the war are coming too quickly, he exclaimed after yet another triumph on the battlefield. The diplomats at U.S. Embassy in Tokyo, turned into enemy aliens overnight, were confined to their compound and initially had to accept Japanese police officers swarming all over the area, peering through the windows of the buildings, and sometimes even stepping into their private rooms. The theory that we were prisoners to be treated as criminal prisoners was clearly the attitude of the police from the very beginning, U.S. Ambassador Joseph Grew commented. Otto Talicius, the Tokyo correspondent for the New York Times, was arrested on trumped-up charges of espionage the moment the war began. After the initial scare, he noticed that almost all his prison guards were exceedingly friendly, which he took as a bad sign, since it suggested to him that they were feeling good about the progress of the war. His gut feeling was confirmed when, after a period of complete isolation from outside news, police officers showed him photos of American targets destroyed across the Central and Western Pacific. Well, Talicius said with slightly veiled sarcasm, under the circumstances, I can only congratulate you on your success. He later recalled the officer's reaction. They smiled. I knew they would see nothing wrong in their treachery, and the irony escaped them. Among Japan's political elite, who were very well aware of their nation's strengths and weaknesses and did not receive their news filtered through a screen of propaganda, the mood was also rising, but with an unmistakable accompanying note of caution. The military achievements attained by the Japanese armed forces at the initial stage of the war, including the surprise attack on Pearl Harbor, were brilliant, wrote Kido Koichi, the emperor's closest advisor after the war. The nation was intoxicated, as it were, with an unbroken string of victories gained by the Japanese armed forces at various fronts in quick succession, one after another. I, as one of the Japanese nationals, shared their rejoicings, but nonetheless, I could not believe in spite of myself that Japan would be able to emerge victorious from this war. Japan's military and political leaders had run a huge, but they believed calculated risk when embarking on war with the Western powers, and initially the gamble had paid off beyond all expectations. However, they all knew that Japan was weaker than the West in all respects, and that this weakness would show up even more clearly beyond the short term. This put an early end to some of the wilder Japanese ambitions. For instance, in the heady days after the success at Pearl Harbor, the Japanese Navy toyed in a serious way with the idea of occupying Hawaii, but the plan never got anywhere near materializing due to logistical concerns. Feeding an occupying army, along with the civilian population, would have required a steady stream of supply vessels sailing to the Hawaiian Islands, exposed to the threat of the potent U.S. submarine force. Kido, determined even at this early stage to seek ways for peace with America and Britain. It was my belief, he said, that Japan would commit an irretrievable blunder if she went too deep in it, elated over her initial successes. This fear haunted me from the very beginning. Japan's Axis partners in Europe were generally excited, but not universally so. When the Pacific War was just a few hours old, Italy's foreign minister, Count Galeazzo Ciano, received a nightly phone call from his German counterpart, Joachim von Ribbentrop. "He is joyful over the Japanese attack on the United States. He is so happy, in fact, that I can't but congratulate him," Ciano wrote in his diary, while keeping a level head himself. German propaganda minister Joseph Goebbels had noted with some annoyance that his government had not been informed beforehand about the Japanese attack, but put it down to the need to maintain secrecy. "Triggering this war, the Japanese have opted for bold tactics," Goebbels recorded in his diary. The Nazi Party mouthpiece, Wilkischer Beobachter, blamed the general agent of Judum, Mr. Franklin Roosevelt, for the outbreak of war in the Pacific, describing Japan as the natural political center of the nations in the region. "The peoples of these countries are acting in their own interest by cooperating closely with Tokyo," the newspaper said in an editorial. German dictator Adolf Hitler himself had nothing but sympathy for the Japanese actions. "There are certain situations in the life of a great power when it must resort to arms if it doesn't want to give up completely. This kind of situation has arisen for Japan," he told his closest aides. "They have had an amazing start and can now dominate the Pacific in an almost uninhibited manner." More importantly, Japan's aggression fit completely into Hitler's own plans for the war. Tensions with the United States had intensified over the preceding months, and a state of undeclared war already existed in the Atlantic, where American warships had become semi-belligerents, persuading him that the official peace between Washington and Berlin could not last. Previously, his plan for German great power status had been to defeat the Soviet Union first and then turn to the United States. With the U.S. administration under Franklin D. Roosevelt becoming ever more deeply involved in its support of Britain, it was clear that the Americans were a threat that needed to be settled much earlier, even before having definitively dealt with the Soviet enemy. In this light, according to Hitler, the events of December were no inconvenience. Rather, it was unbelievably lucky that Japan had dragged the United States into the war and would keep it occupied for the foreseeable future in the Pacific. "Now, the East Asia conflict falls into our lap like a present," he said, beaming with joy. According to the German Führer's logic, the best he could do was to add to America's woes by forcing it into a two-ocean conflict, which involved not just the Pacific, but also the Atlantic. And on December 11th, he declared war on the United States. Thus, in a matter of days, Japan's attack on Pearl Harbor had connected the separate wars in Europe and Asia and turned them into a genuinely global conflict, affecting most of mankind one way or the other. "Now," Goebbels wrote in his diary, "this war has become a world war in the truest sense of the word." Half a world away, Admiral Ugaki Matome, chief of staff of the Japanese Navy's main ocean-going units assembled in the combined fleet, expressed the exact same thought as the German propaganda minister. "Now it really has turned out to be the Second World War," Ugaki wrote in his diary. "The whole world will revolve around our empire." Japan had opted for a meeting with destiny, but its senior leaders knew that they had to play their cards exactly right, or they would lose everything. The Japanese expansion across the Western Pacific and Southeast Asia in the weeks after Pearl Harbor betrayed a feverish, all-consuming ambition. And from an outsider's point of view, it was not always easy to discern any overall logic. Ordinary Japanese soldiers often had little or no understanding of why they were going to war. This conversation, taking place among soldiers heading south in December, was typical. "We can't be going east. Our fleet is moving south. Are we going to Borneo? What on earth for? To join the guerrillas and the cannibals? Idiot, there's oil there." Japan's foes, too, were confused. "Look what they are doing out here, jumping all over the map instead of meeting at one or two places," a British officer said. The Japanese were indeed scattered across the map in the winter of 1941-42, but not in a random manner. It was all according to a carefully laid plan, and despite the disparaging view of many of its enemies, Japan was remarkably successful. Ultimately, the objective was to gain access to the natural riches of Asia. The main prize was the oil in the Dutch-controlled East Indies, without which the Japanese Empire and its war machine would grind to a halt. But it was more than that. Japan's economy, ravaged by a decade of conflict in China, including 4 years of all-out war, also coveted other resources, such as the tin and rubber of the Malay Peninsula. The Japanese commanders were under two major constraints. The first constraint was one of manpower. From day one, they lacked soldiers and had to spread their troops thinly in order to implement their plans for conquest. Some units had to be used twice, participating in one campaign only to immediately move on to the next. It was war on a shoestring, and it was only going to get worse. The Japanese could not count on ever being able to match the British, the Dutch, the Australians, and especially the Americans in basic material terms. The United States was temporarily weakened, but soon it would have more of everything. Therefore, it was necessary to essentially win the war psychologically. The U.S. democracy, considered inherently weak by the Japanese, was to be persuaded that continued fighting would entail sacrifice of such magnitude that a compromise solution and a negotiated peace was the only palatable alternative. A fait accompli had to be established, and a defensive perimeter was to be set up as far out in the Pacific as possible before the Americans gathered strength to hit back. This led to the second constraint the Japanese commanders were facing. They did not have much time. Admiral Yamamoto Isoroku, the commander-in-chief of the combined fleet, had hinted at this problem even before the war broke out. "If I am told to fight, regardless of the consequences, I shall run wild for the first 6 months or a year," he had told Prime Minister Konoe Fumimaro. "But I have utterly no confidence for the second or third year." In other words, the war would be decided for Japan during the first 12 months. Its military was on a tight schedule, and the top brass further exacerbated this by imposing on themselves a seemingly impossible deadline. Having disappointed the emperor with the endless quagmire in China, they now wanted to show that they could not just achieve their stated objectives, but even exceed them. Hirohito had voiced doubts that the operation to seize Southeast Asia could be completed within 5 months. In response, the officers resolved to pledge on the honor of the Southern armies to firmly live up to His Majesty's considerations by completing the Southern operation within the term scheduled by Imperial General Headquarters. In a more profound sense, the urgency the Japanese leaders were experiencing was a problem of their own making. They struggled to complete their conquests as early as possible in order to prevent Allied reinforcements of the areas under attack. By this, of course, they did not mean reinforcements from Great Britain or the Netherlands, which were in no shape to hit back anytime soon. The former involved in a life-and-death struggle against Germany, and the latter occupied by the same power. It was America which could and would retaliate. It was a matter of almost diabolic irony that it did not have to be this way. The main rationale for attacking Pearl Harbor had been fear that the United States would interfere with the Japanese conquest of Southeast Asia. In the event, the Japanese blitzkrieg in late 1941 and early 1942 was carried out with such speed that the American Navy would not have made any difference. It suggested that, in the Japanese debate for and against attacking Pearl Harbor, the opponents of this rash act might have been right. It had not been necessary to destroy the U.S. Pacific Fleet in order to bring the war in Southeast Asia to a victorious conclusion. Now, it had nevertheless been done, and Japan had awakened a sleeping giant. "A date which will live in infamy," U.S. President Franklin D. Roosevelt had called that fateful Sunday when Pearl Harbor was struck. He gave voice to a feeling of immense anger affecting Americans of all ages and occupations, at home and abroad alike. John Donovan, an American pilot who had volunteered to fly for the Chinese side, was alerted to the news about the war within hours, and on December 8th, he expressed the sentiments of many of his compatriots when he argued that what had happened reflected not just Japanese boldness, but also misplaced American softness. "Well, today they have gone and done it. You have to give the guys credit for nerve," he wrote in a letter home. "It should never have happened. A big country like the U.S. standing by complacently, trying to conciliate with the murderers. Yes, that's the trouble with a democracy showing too much kindness to the wrong people. During the first confused days, the Americans had only limited chances of striking back. The U.S. held island of Guam, a fueling station for U.S. Navy vessels en route to or from Asia, had been under bombardment since the beginning of hostilities in the Pacific. At 4 a.m. on December 10th, a landing force of 400 Japanese waded onto Dunkus Beach, a few miles north of the capital of Agana. The Japanese marched into the central square of the city, where the Insular Force Guard, a unit made up of 80 local recruits, awaited them with nothing more than rifles and a few 30-caliber machine guns. The Insular Force Guard stood their ground and opened up a fire with machine guns and rifles, hot enough to halt the invading force for a short time, Guam Governor George J. McMillan wrote in a post-war account. The shooting lasted for less than an hour. The situation was simply hopeless. Resistance had been carried to the limit. Three blasts were sounded on the horn of an automobile which was standing on the square in front of the governor's residence. This was not a prearranged signal to cease fire, but it seemed to have been understood by both sides, and the firing stopped immediately, McMillan said. The atoll Wake, another U.S. possession, was better prepared and equipped, and held out for longer, even though the odds were terrifying. Consisting of three small islands located 1,500 miles east of Guam and more than 2,000 miles west of Hawaii, Wake looked lonely on the map. And the troops stationed on the island, 500 U.S. Marines under the command of Major James Devereaux, would be excused if they felt like the loneliest garrison in the world. Reinforced by civilian workers employed on construction projects, they had been subjected to Japanese air attack since shortly after Pearl Harbor. And early on December 11th, a Japanese fleet, consisting of three cruisers, six destroyers, and several other vessels arrived from the Marshalls, attempting to land 450 men on the island. While the Japanese ships began their bombardment, the Marines lay in wait, with three batteries of coastal artillery under strict orders to hold fire until the very last minute. When the Americans finally opened up, it worked to devastating effect. First Lieutenant Clarence A. Barninger later described what happened after his battery opened fire on the cruiser Yubari at a distance of less than 6,000 yards. The ship immediately belched smoke and steam through the side, and her speed diminished. After some time, she got slowly underway, going a short distance, stopping, and continuing again. She was engulfed in smoke when she crept over the horizon. Another cruiser, the Hayate, received three salvos. Broke in two, and sank rapidly, with 168 killed and no survivors. The Japanese opted for breaking off the operation, and as they retired, they were pursued by four American Grumman F-4F Wildcat aircraft, which had survived the air raids of the previous days and now also entered the battle, spreading havoc among the enemy ships. Amid unexpected defeat, the Japanese grudgingly admitted they had met stronger opposition than expected. Our Navy admires the ability and courage of the pilots and fighters that defended Wake in the operation, Naval Aviator Captain Yamaoka Mineo said in a post-war interview. The airplane pilots were very brave and skillful. While the Wake garrison was fighting for its life, the U.S. Navy at Pearl Harbor worked frantically to organize reinforcement. By mid-December, Task Force 14, commanded by Rear Admiral Frank Jack Fletcher, and consisting of carrier USS Saratoga, as well as three cruisers, nine destroyers, and support vessels, was heading west towards the beleaguered island, but it was hampered by the speed of its slowest member, the oiler Nietzsche's, commissioned in 1921. At the same time, the Japanese were done licking their wounds and prepared a second attack on Wake. It was to take place in the night between December 22nd and 23rd, and this time, 2,000 Japanese soldiers were to disembark. In addition to significantly boosting the force that had failed in the first attempt to invade the island, the Japanese commanders chose new tactics. Wake was to be taken by surprise, under cover of darkness. As the second Japanese invasion force reached waters off Wake shortly after 2 a.m., Japanese soldiers, wearing white headbands so they could more easily identify each other in the dark, clambered into assault boats and moved quietly towards the shore, By the time they stepped on to Wake, they had been detected, in one case because of their injudicious use of pyrotechnic signals as a means of communicating. But it was too late to halt the invasion. Fierce battles broke out in the hour before dawn. A Japanese intelligence officer described the hand-to-hand fighting with the American enemy for one of the artillery positions. "Charge!" the commander's voice rang out. We jumped to our feet and charged. Huge shadows which shouted something unintelligible were pierced one after another. One large figure appeared before us to blaze away with a machine gun from his hip, as they do in American gangster films. Somebody went for him with his bayonet and went down together with his victim. Little by little, the outmanned and outgunned Marines had to yield key positions. We secretly circled behind the enemy's line, the unnamed intelligence officer wrote. Then, hurling our hand grenades, we charged into the enemy. In this manner, the artillery position which had troubled us so much up to the present was captured. Even so, the Americans were determined to put up a fight, and in a bold counterattack, they routed an entire unit of 100 soldiers, witnessing a rare scene of panic among the Japanese. Some 30 of them eventually attempted to hide or take shelter under and about a single Marine searchlight truck and were killed where they crouched, wrote the official Marine Corps historian. None volunteered to surrender. Successes such as this were only local. There were simply too few soldiers on the U.S. side, and they were spread out too thinly to defend a coastline that added up to 21 miles on the main island alone. A further blow, this time mostly psychological, came with the light of day, when the American defenders saw themselves surrounded by Japanese warships on all sides. Some counted 16 vessels, others 27. There are no friendly ships within 24 hours, the Marine Commander Devereaux was told by one of his officers. Not even submarines? He asked, receiving the disappointing answer. Not even them. At 8 a.m., Devereaux walked towards the Japanese line, carrying a white rag tied to a swab handle. While the U.S. forces surrendered on Wake, Task Force 14 received orders from Pearl Harbor to turn around. The decision was greeted by the members of the relief force with shock, anger, and a rebellious attitude. Some advised Fletcher to disobey the command and head straight for Wake. Fletcher, of course, ignored these recommendations. Had he continued on his mission, he might have scored an early victory for the U.S. Navy, as several of the Japanese vessels that had participated in the invasion were now sitting targets at Wake. It would probably not have turned the tide of battle, or kept Wake in American hands, but it would have been an early boost to American morale at a time when everything else seemed bleak. This was all in the realm of what might have been. In the real world, Wake did mark the first major U.S. attempt at fighting back against the Japanese juggernaut, but any benefit to the mood at home was counterbalanced by the strategic loss of a vital strong point in the vast expanses of the Central Pacific. Chapter 2. Asia Engulfed. Late December, 1941. The Japanese pilots flying over the Philippines in the first days after Pearl Harbor were experiencing an entirely new form of war. Many of them were veterans from the long conflict in China, where they had been facing Chinese and sometimes Soviet aviators in Russian-built planes. Now, in the midst of the crucial battle for control of the Philippine skies as a prelude to the planned invasion of the islands, they were up against Americans in U.S.-built aircraft. They found to their relief that their own Mitsubishi A6M Zero fighter was a more than adequate match for the American P-40, as the Japanese plane outshone its U.S. counterpart in everything except diving acceleration. The confidence of our fighter pilots continued to grow, nurtured by the absence of effective opposition, wrote Shimada Koichi on the staff of the 11th Air Fleet, which had the responsibility for air operations over the Philippines. The Philippines, under the overall command of General Douglas MacArthur, was not Wake. And yet, despite its much larger size and more awe-inspiring defensive potential, it was essentially just another piece of U.S.-held territory that the military planners in Washington had to effectively abandon beforehand. In the tense years prior to the outbreak of war in the Pacific, the U.S. government, faced with the likelihood of being sucked into the ongoing war in Europe, had been forced to allocate desperately scarce military resources elsewhere. adequate reinforcements for the Philippines at this time, according to General George C. Marshall, the U.S. Army's chief of staff, would have left the United States in a position of great peril should there be a break in the defense of Great Britain. What was not clear at the time was the fact that the Japanese were similarly constrained, and that the Japanese High Command intended to take the Philippines with the smallest feasible number of troops. Placed in command of the Japanese 14th Army, which was to conquer the Philippines, was 54-year-old General Homa Masaharu. He incorporated many of the paradoxes of the high-level officers of the Japanese military who oversaw the rapid expansion of Hirohito's empire in the winter of 1941 and 1942. They were men who had set out on their careers respecting, and in many cases, even appreciating the nations of the West. Some developed deep personal attachments. Homa, for one, had been a military student with the East Lancashire Regiment 3 decades earlier, and during World War I, he had been assigned to serve with the British 2nd Army headquarters in France. Of course, this paled in comparison to the officer's sense of duty towards the Emperor, and once war broke out, his loyalties were not in doubt. On December 10th, about 48 hours after Japanese airplanes had started dropping bombs over the Philippines, the first invasion troops, consisting of about 5,000 men, disembarked on 2 locations at the northern end of Luzon, the largest island of the Philippine archipelago. The purpose of the operation was to seize airfields in preparation of a larger invasion planned for later in the month. Despite the heavy blow that the U.S. Army Air Force had received at the outset of the campaign, it was still able to inflict at least a psychological toll on the invaders. For the Japanese troops waiting on ships off the invasion beaches, the scattered U.S. air raids were their baptism of fire, and their commanders requested air support to ward off the threat. The Japanese landings were limited in scope, as per the overall need to use only the very minimum of troops for each operation, but the mere presence of the enemy created a deep sense of unease. "The rat was in the house, and it was no comfort," said General Jonathan M. Wainwright, the senior U.S. commander in northern Luzon. Nervousness abounded. On the same day as the landings, about 100 miles further south, a single Japanese reconnaissance vessel was detected, setting off a furious barrage from Philippine artillery inland, fired in the belief that an entire invasion force was underway. "It was like dropping a match in a warehouse of 4th of July fireworks," an American advisor to the Philippine unit wrote. The American commanders had to husband their resources, and they considered the landings in the north to be a feint ahead of a larger invasion elsewhere. The same was true for their reaction on December 12th, when yet another small detachment of about 2,500 Japanese troops landed in Legazpi Harbor in the south of Luzon. A story, possibly apocryphal, was later related about the railway station master in the harbor calling U.S. military representatives in Manila to inform them that the Japanese had arrived and were standing in his office. "See what they want," the officer in Manila ordered. The station master replied, "Those Japs want me to give them a train to take them to Manila, sir. What do I do now?" The officer in Manila reacted promptly. "Tell them the next train leaves a week from Sunday. Don't give it to them." The landings in both north and south of Luzon were only preliminaries to the main Japanese invasion, which the Americans knew was coming. They had to wait exactly 10 days for that to take place. At 5:17 a.m. on December 22nd, the first men of a Japanese landing force numbering more than 34,000 waded ashore at Lingayen Gulf, about 100 miles north of Manila. The invasion, carried out by the 14th Army under the command of General Homa, got off to a bad start, as the ships missed the landing beaches in the dark and high seas made a mess of the disembarkation. The U.S. commanders had guessed the invasion zone, since the Gulf was the natural place to carry out a landing. Still, they did not prepare any major efforts to oppose the invader, and the Japanese, meeting only limited resistance from the two.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.